turn on the recording, and I stare into my camera, and I say, Ham Radio Now, episode 33. What the heck is TAPR and the DCC anyway? I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and with me here on my Skype line is somebody who should be able to answer that question, Steve Bible N7HPR. Hey, Steve, how you doing?
I'm doing really good, Gary. How are you?
And I believe you are the president of TAPR at this point, right?
Yeah, that is correct. I am still the president and
stuck with it for another year.
Yeah.
All right. The reason why we're going through this is Ham Radio Now is about to put online a series of 17 videos from the Digital Communications Conference that TAPR and the ARRL sponsored that was put on back in September. And we're just about to get them going. And what I thought we'd do is talk a little bit about what TAPR is and the DCC is in the hopes of getting some people in the audience more familiar with what all this is and more interested in watching the programs. So let's give that a try and we'll see where we can go with it. And I'm not sure how much of a TAPR historian you are. Do you know much about the background? Have you been steeped how long have you been playing TAPR?
I've been playing with TAPR since 1985.
Okay. That's some pretty good history.
Right. I take that back. 1995. I got to get my decade straight.
That's not as much
TAPR
history.
Does go, yeah, I'm sorry. But if you go all the way back to 1985 time frame, actually 1983, when TAPR was formed, and it was for the purpose of promoting packet radio within amateur radio.
Now, the initials, TAPR, correct me if I'm wrong, Tucson Amateur Packet Radio.
And that is correct. And it was in Tucson, Arizona that the group organized and
so
incorporated.
Now, I'm thinking it's kind of like KFC. It's just TAPR. There's not much Tucson left, is there?
No, there's not. All of those members have since moved on to different places, different jobs, and new people have come in, and they're all around the United States.
And there is some packet still, but it's not the driving force.
That is true. Now, of course, what has been TAPR's beginning, let's call it packet radio, has now morphed into TAPR is an amateur radio research and development organization.
Yeah, so the AR part is what's left, the amateur radio.
True.
And we just call it TAPR.
And we just call it TAPR, and we just keep it simple. That way we don't get kind of misconstrued as we are in the location of TAPR or that happens to be the mission.
Where is the home office now? Where is headquarters?
It's headquarters now in Richardson, Texas.
Okay, and you are in Phoenix.
I am in the Phoenix area.
But
yes.
That's just by coincidence. Your president, the officers could be any place.
That is true, and the officers are in Oregon, Washington, Ohio. They're all in Australia, for that matter. So they're all over the place.
So what the brief synopsis? What is TAPR all about? What is it you guys do these days?
Well, we as we mentioned, we are a research and development organization. We promote the education, the advancing the radio art, and for the TAPR membership, they're generally those people who like to be on the bleeding edge of amateur radio technology.
But there is a focus still on digital technology. Is it an exclusive focus, or is that just sort of kind of the way things go?
I think it's kind of the way things go. Digital techniques or digital technologies is certainly one of the areas as we see even throughout our lives. Take a look at television. It was once analog for many, many years and then just recently completely transitioned over to digital. And just take a look at here, you and I on Skype. This is all digital, voice over IP, for example. So digital techniques are prevalent in our entire lives. And for the membership of TAPR and the experimenters, they want to use similar techniques.
Well, the history, I'm going back to packet radio. Packet was some of the original digital stuff in ham radio. So I guess TAPR has just followed along with staying in the digital domain for the most part.
And then that's a good assessment, and that's quite true.
So who are the members of TAPR? How big are you, and where are they, and who are they?
Okay, so they're basically south of about 1,000 members right at this time. And they are the people who enjoy being on the bleeding edge of technology. They enjoy learning new things. They enjoy sharing ideas. And they would like to have a place where they can get their hands on some of the newest hardware that they can play with and experiment with.
What are the backgrounds of some of these people? If someone is interested in getting into TAPR, should they worry that they are not one of the world's foremost electrical engineers involved in digital technology? Do you have a place for people that are sort of in the middle?
I think there's people from all ends that can enjoy what TAPR has to offer. And I do believe our membership has all those different kinds of people. For one, we have those that are the innovators. They're the ones who are creating the new technology. And if you look at it from a percentage point of view, they're really the minority. So there's a handful of people that are really doing, creating, and putting out either new hardware or new software. And then the vast majority, and they come from all walks of life, and they don't have to be an engineer or a scientist. They just have a genuine interest in the technology, and most of them just have an insatiable appetite to learn. They're the ones end up being the users of the technology that the creators or the innovators make.
So I would guess that there's a lot of education going on.
And there really is, because one of the things that we recognize in TAPR is being a community. And it's within that community that the users kind of dictate or express what it is they would like to do. The innovators or the designers would say, okay, here's what I can accomplish, and code something up or create some hardware, throw it out there. Here you go. What do you think? And it becomes a big feedback loop that continues to basically build on each other. And that, of course, makes for TAPR having been in existence for over 30 years.
And I guess a big component of that education is the DCC. And I don't want to talk about that yet. I want to hang off a little bit. What I want to talk about is some of the hardware and software you're talking about. TAPR originally developed some TNCs, terminal node controllers, back before anybody else did, I guess, or at least when they were still very, very young.
Well, TAPR is interesting because you go back to the original membership. The first packet radio was actually done by a Canadian group. If we go back that far, ASCII over ham radio was not legal in the United States, but it was in Canada. So the first packet radio kits came out of Canada. So the first of the membership actually got their hands on one of those and said, hey, let's design, let's build our own, and which that's what became the first TNC1 kit. And then that was sold, and really, then the rest, as they say, is history.
But that was used only in Canada or other TNC places where it was legal? At what point did the U.S. get on board?
Well, and it was shortly after the U.S. did allow ASCII to be legal in the U.S., and that therefore made the TNC1 legal in the United States, and also made the original VADCA TNC legal in the United States as well.
Was TAPR instrumental in getting the FCC to add that mode to our list of things we're allowed to do?
I would think the answer to that is yes. I don't have firsthand knowledge of that, but given that TAPR was very much on the forefront of packet radio in the U.S., that would be likely.
I would guess so, because who else was going to do it?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, so there were the couple of original TNCs, and then where did things develop in terms of hardware from there?
Well, the packet radio actually had quite a long life and then basically segued into APRS. There was a number of accessories that were being developed. Then timing became another hot area within amateur radio, being able to have accurate timing. And a lot of that was benefited by the new technology that we today call Global Positioning System, or GPS. So we use GPS for accurate timing. And
so
that
TAPR,
led to,
TAPR invented GPS.
Yeah, we would like to think so. We certainly pioneered a lot of the use of GPS within amateur radio with respect to timing. I'd have to say that Bob Berninga gets credit for using GPS for positioning, and of course that's what we have today in the APRS. And so TAPR was a big supporter of APRS.
Yeah, I think Bob kind of wishes that he never did the GPS part of APRS. I've heard him talk many times about it, where he says it's not a global, it's not a tracking system.
It is. He's absolutely right. It's a lot more than just positioning. About in the year 2000, TAPR got involved in software-defined radio, and then worked on the DSP-10 kit. And then today we're working on the high-performance SDR project with the Open HPSDR group. So that's the hardware that we've been producing today.
Yeah, and I've been impressed by the HPSDR stuff, and I got a feeling that almost nobody in the audience, except for the TAPR folks that we've gathered to watch this, have any idea what we're talking about with HPSDR. Spend a little time describing what that stuff is.
Well, what's interesting is a group of hams got together, and there was a lot of SDR going on. It goes back to articles in QST and QEX, and little simple SDR projects like the Soft Rock. But this group of hams decided they really wanted to build the Ferrari. They really wanted to have the race car version. They no holds barred. They wanted high performance. And so they designed with the intent of making it as high performance as they could. And then was another aspect, which was very clever, that they wanted to make it modular. So they developed a backplane. And each of the cards then had a specific purpose in mind, and you plugged it into the backplane. The idea is that as that board gets superseded by newer technology, better technology, that board could be redesigned, pulled out of your kit, and then plug in the new board, and then it would be expandable and, you know, live on forever from there. What's interesting about that project, several boards have been developed in this plug-in backplane, and now the latest project spinoff from this has been Hermes, which is basically saying, okay, let's take the best of all what we have and create a radio that's on one single board. And this is looking to be a very promising project right now. And for those that would like to learn more about Open HPSDR, is they can go to www.openhpsdr.org, and there's all the information. It's an open project, open hardware, and open software, so you can sit there and take a look at schematics, Gerber files, source code, and really dive in as deep as you want.
Now, this radio that we're talking about, the HPSDR radio, is, in terms of what you do with it on the air, it's just an HF radio. It's a, you know, sideband, CW, your basic HF modes.
It is your HF modes, but of course it's doing the digital aspect of it incredibly well and incredibly high performance. Being able to look at wide bandwidths, graphic displays, and then the ability to experiment with different modes. And then for those that want to go up to the VHF and UHF frequencies, then they use transverters. So it can be used for more than just a plain old HF radio and plain old HF modes.
But that may be the core of what it can do. You could hear somebody using one of these radios on 20 meters.
Oh, absolutely. And there's many people that have HPSDR radios built up, and they have, and I don't have to brag about it. You can just go out onto the Open HPSDR forums and just read what people are saying about the performance of these radios, how they have made them their primary radio, and just how they just outperform everything that they've ever had.
So I'm saying that I could run into somebody that's talking on 20 meters with one of those, but I never have. I'm not I'm not 20 meters most prolific user, but how likely am I to actually run into somebody on the air talking on one of those? There's not thousands and thousands of them, are there?
Yeah, and that brings up another point. When you talk about being an organization, and we promote the research and development, the bleeding edge of amateur radio, as it says, digital techniques. And as I mentioned, the membership of TAPR is south of 1,000 members. Even during the packet radio days, it was several thousand. You know, when you look at the entire ham population in the United States, and we know it to be north of 750,000 hams, and then we can narrow that down and say, okay, how many of those are active? And then how many of those really want to be experimenters doing the things that TAPR does? You find out it's really down to a minority. So is there 1,000 of these open HPSDR radios on the air? The answer is no. Something south of 1,000, but it's north of 500. But it just seems to be that if you're into experimentation and you're not afraid to use screwdrivers and soldering irons and piece together a radio, this is the group for you. And, you know, if you're waiting for a turnkey solution, then what you'll have to do is wait for the manufacturers to adopt this technology. This is a group of people creating this technology, making it open, and anybody can use it after the fact.
Now, there are manufacturers that are adopting and I think even cooperating in some of this technology. The two big companies that are doing software-defined radio these days would be Flex and Elecraft. And I think even ICOM and Yaesu and Kenwood are incorporating some digital technology in their radios, SDR-type technology. But Flex and Elecraft call their radios software-defined radios. And the people that run those companies have been involved in TAPR, if I'm not mistaken.
And the answer is correct. They have been, and of course, when we get to talking about the Digital Communications Conference, they have been in attendance of the DCC. They have been buying the TAPR kits, and they've been putting, you know, learning right along with the rest of the community and being able to turn those back around into their products.
And this HPSDR radio that you guys have been working on for a while, as I can demonstrate both my ignorance and my ability to learn a little bit by describing some of it, and you can go a little bit farther than I can. The thing that impressed me as I was listening to the descriptions of it were that this radio from the receiver end starts with an antenna connector, goes to a filter, goes to a analog to digital converter. You know, three steps and we are digital, and then everything else happens in the digital domain. Do I have that even close to being correct?
And you do, because what the goal of software-defined radio is to get that analog to digital converter as close to the antenna as possible. We want to get that RF digitized as soon as we can, and then once it's a bit, once it can become numbers, then we can basically number crunch it to our heart intent.
Yeah, and I'm mostly going back to a talk that Phil Harmon gave, VK7APH, I think. I'm probably butchering his call pretty badly. This is okay. A couple of years ago, and he was the Sunday talk at the DCC, and he described how he designed the software for the Mercury receiver.
How do we get around this problem? Well, the way we do it is to get rid of all the analog components. If there's no analog components, then we haven't got them causing any INQ problems. This is the ideal architecture for a fully digital approach. We haven't got there yet, and you know, we may do sometime into the future, but at the moment, we can't actually implement this. But if you had a blank piece of paper and limited budget and said, I want to do this fully digitally, this is what you'd do. You take your antenna and you connect it directly to your analog to digital converter. You take the output of your analog to digital converter and put it into a digital signal processor. And you take the output from your digital signal processor, and if it's a digital mode, that's as far as you need to go. You've got it's a PSK31 or RTTY, etc. You don't need to necessarily listen to that signal. If it's a sideband or CW or other mode that you want to listen to, you put it back through a digital to analog converter.
And that's where I learned the most about it. And the only way I really learned very much about it was that I was editing it. And so I was playing the same things over and over and over again. And eventually a few things sort of seeped in and I was going, whoa. Flex, which may be the most SDR of the off-the-shelf SDR systems, was not doing that at that point. They had several analog steps before they went into digital, and then they shoved things into your computer and did some digital processing at that point, and then back out to the radio. So this system was ahead of anything else, anything that anybody was doing commercially, anything that anybody was doing at all in ham radio. I'm sure that somewhere there's some esoteric commercial and government stuff being done that way, but they were literally the leading edge inside of ham radio.
And that's the purpose of the group, and that's where the TAPR membership wants to be. Once it becomes mainstream, then, well, it's mainstream at that point. You know, they follow the trends. They want to know what's the newest, latest thing. That's what drives them. That's what interests them.
So speaking of things going mainstream, at Dayton this year, as I was talking to the fellows at Flex, they had a new radio out. And that sounded an awful lot like the HPSDR radio. They moved the processing from whatever computer you were connecting to into a processor that was built into the radio. And your computer became more just a control system.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, the technology is a digital down converter, which the early HPSDR our group was experimenting with. It's in the Mercury receiver, it's in the Hermes, and then now it's in the latest Flex radio. So yeah, that technology was definitely experimented with by this group as much as you say 3 years ago. And of course with Flex announcing it as at Dayton, so the Flex 6000. But it also shows you that, you know, the technology or the ability to buy the ICs, the integrated circuits, in order to experiment with this is available to all people. It's just a matter of course, you know, it does require some advanced techniques. In other words, you're not going to solder this down with a plumber's soldering iron. But this is where TAPR comes in and helps out with the manufacturing and be able to get these boards out to the people who want to use them. So hardware is one aspect of it. And then, of course, once you can get the hardware out there, now you can get the software. And there's more people that are willing to work on software, but they got to have the hardware.
So TAPR supply some of the hardware. You design and build prototypes of the hardware and make boards and parts kits and stuff like that available for a while, but not forever.
Oh, yeah. And again, this is always being on the bleeding edge. What we do is we take measure of the projects and that, of course, what's the level of interest in order for us to produce it at a cost-effective amount for, you know, the people to be able to buy it. It's certainly not the cheapest because it's not mass produced. It's not mainstream. So there's that aspect. And
it's not necessarily perfected either.
True. I mean, the community is in getting involved with the development of this. And so they know that it's not turnkey. They know that it's not 100%, but they follow along in the community and they can see how well it works. And the support system is there. So instead of calling 1-800-HELP-ME, Basically, they go up to the forum and have a conversation, and everybody gets to see what people are asking questions about. So the community aspect of it cannot be stressed more. And it's the community that gets involved in these projects and supports each other with these projects. Now, once it becomes mainstream, which is to say other people will take on the task of building and selling, and let's say it becomes more turnkey, more and more hams will get involved with it, because those who don't want to turn a wrench or use a soldering iron but want it turnkey will then purchase that. TAPR then moves on and will basically scout out whatever that next technology is. So the run of that hardware is limited.
You have some partners. The one I'm thinking of right now is the initials that we've been mentioning, HPSDR. That's actually an organization that partners with TAPR.
And it's a loose group of people that have gotten together and formed the Open HPSDR group. They're not incorporated, or they don't have membership, they don't have officers, so really it's a community, let's call it.
So they're a website.
I guess that would be fair to say. And with that group of people that have done the development, then what they did is they approached TAPR and asked if TAPR would produce the hardware for them, of which we were glad to do for them.
And that there are some companies that, once TAPR is done building boards, pick up some of them and continue to manufacture them for a reasonable period of time. But there's stuff that you built, that you've designed and built prototype boards and initial run boards that are not available anymore. They're just gone.
Oh, and yeah, that's true. They're just gone. The only thing, that's why we want to do open projects where the schematics, the Gerber files, the bill of materials, and the firmware that goes in them is all available. So if you want to, you could build it up yourself.
Okay, but making circuit boards probably will be difficult. So we're saying get in on this early. If you want to play with this stuff, don't wait until it's been perfected by TAPR, because it's not going to be. Get in early and play now.
Yeah, no, that's a fair assessment, and there's a lot of people who discover the community, get involved with it, and then of course there's a lot of people who discover it after the fact and wonder how they can get in and play when in fact all of the hardware has been sold and gone.
So they're going to be playing with the next thing, not the last thing. And what is the next thing? The HPSDR radio is still being developed. It's becoming more transceiver-like. I guess all the pieces are coming together in smaller and more integrated boards. Is that still pretty much the primary focus on hardware right now?
Well, it is. And what it's doing is it's taken all of the lessons learned up to the point, and it's taking advantage of new hardware, cost reductions in that hardware, and consolidation of all of the features into what people are really looking for, or bringing it down in cost where it's just easier and more manageable. I mean, if you put together a whole open HPSDR radio with all the boards plugging into it, I mean, you're well over $1,500 and just parts. And then, of course, there's, you know, getting it in an enclosure and putting all the nice touches that go around it to make it a whole radio.
But you're going to be spending a lot more than that to buy it from Flex.
Well, and that is true. I mean, if you look at Flex, and of course you can go back to the Flex, you know, 1000, and of course Flex offers up many different radios from high end down to low end. So the Flex 1500, to take for example. So, you know, there's something there for everybody's price range and, you know, however you want to be able to get involved with it and whatever you can afford.
Yeah, but it's their 6000 series, the new one, that is doing the things that the HPSDR system was designed to do. That early transition from analog to digital, very early, just past a filter. Was the HPSDR stuff very directly involved in Flex? Were they working with TAPR and HPSDR in that development and then commercialized it, or did they just go on by themselves to make their own product that does the same things?
Well, they pretty much went on their own to make the product to the specifications that their customers need. So, I mean, that's more power to them in doing that, because they have a particular client base, particular customers that have their requirements, and they're meeting those requirements in that market. TAPR's audience, TAPR's community, is the experimenter. So we're not going to have a nice, clean package, manual,
That their radio is fairly ugly.
Well, eye of the beholder.
they have cleaned it up a little bit over the years as I've been watching the development.
No, I'm glad it's out there. It's a wonderful radio.
Yeah. Do you have one yourself? Did you build one?
Oh, no. I spend too much. Ham radio to me is on the bench. I'm not keying the microphone nearly as much as I used to. So if I describe ham radio, it's on the bench.
Yeah.
It's basically soldering things up.
That's what ham radio, why we are such a wide variety of things. Is not everybody is going to be sitting there rag chewing on 20 meters and 75 meters. And some people talking, once I got the radio working so I could talk on it, go build another radio. And then send the radio that you can talk on to me, because that's about as far as I'm going to be able to go with it.
Okay.
Let's talk about the DCC then, the Digital Communications Conference. That is done by TAPR in cooperation with the ARRL, and it has been going on for a while.
Right. I believe we just completed our 35th annual. And so it's the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference.
The first annual, you were looking at spark rigs and early transition to CW modes, things like that.
Well, and CW is one of the early digital modes, right?
Yeah, I'm trying to provoke a little laugh out there, Steve.
okay.
Yeah, 35 years ago, we weren't running spark. We were 35 years ago. I guess we were running sideband. Was still around. And it wasn't called the DCC at that point. It was...
I believe it was the Computer Networking Conference, the CNC.
So,
and that was started by Paul Rinaldo in the ARRL. So it was an ARRL conference at the time.
And I guess it was just sort of natural that TAPR would get in on it as things became digital and more computers became involved in what we were doing.
Yeah, what had happened is, I believe it was the first time TAPR worked with the ARRL was 1996, and they basically entered into an MOU to work together on that, and TAPR would do the organizing, and ARRL works in supporting and advertising and printing of the proceedings. So it's been a very amicable grouping to be able to put on the DCC, and of course it's been well attended, and of course I think really the proof of the pudding is the technology that comes from that, and looking at what's published in the proceedings and goes on for posterity. Now this is the printed word that goes out there and shows that amateur radio is advancing the radio art.
Let's get just some basic description of what the DCC is all about, with the understanding that if you want to actually see some of it, last year's is online. 2011 is online to watch as online video at Ham Radio Now. Well, that's actually at my old identity as ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News. I think that's where that one still is. But if you go to the hamradionow.tv website, there'll be a link to take you to last year's DCC, and you can watch all of the presentations. But to just sort of summarize what it is all about, it's a 3-day conference, and continue.
Okay, it's a 3-day conference, Friday, Saturday, and half day Sunday, of which Friday and Saturday we have what we call the main session talks, which are mainly people. What we do is we go out with a call for papers in the springtime, and people submit papers on the projects that they're working on, whatever technology, whatever project, that thing that they're working on. Submit the papers, those get published into proceedings, and then we invite the authors to come and present their papers. Now, in order to get published in the papers, you do not have to be present to present it, so there is no requirement in entering a paper into the proceedings. In fact, we highly encourage people to get their projects documented, get those in print. That's really the most important thing in showing that amateur radio is advancing the radio art. It's wonderful that it's in on a web page, and it's wonderful that there's a forum out there, but what really solidifies that technology is when it's published in a proceedings. And at the talks, we have the paper presenters, and we have invited speakers, and we present just a variety of technology that's being experimented with amateur radio. So those who come to the DCC as the audience are basically there to hear what is going on, what is new, what is driving amateur radio today. And really, you're going to be seeing things that in 5 years from now will become the mainstream.
5 years or maybe even more. These talks are each about 40, 45 minutes long. And there are generally about eight of them on Saturday, eight of them on Friday, and eight of them on Saturday. And they go through a lot of different stuff. I'm just looking over this year's. You presented a review of what Arisat had done a talk about the AMSAT Fox project. Scotty Cowling, W2DFI, talked about where things stood with the HPSDR. He does that every year. Mm-hmm. SDR architecture. And then a somewhat more operational talk, so they're not all deep into technology. Hailing channel for packet radio. So there's a really wide variety of things. Some of them are hardware, some of them are software, some of them aren't so much either. They're more more operational, and they're many of them are very technical. Not all of them are really seriously technical. A lot of it's over my head. But as I edit them and watch them over and over again, I start to understand some things. But some of them I can understand right away because they're right where I live in terms of technology. So it is a wide variety.
It is a wide variety: hardware, software, and operational. And what's interesting about the operational, that's inspiration to the hardware and software developers, because that is your audience. That's who you're building that radio for. So those are the operational talks are well received within the DCC.
And in addition to those main talks, there are a separate set on Saturday of introductory talks that are specifically designed for the less technical audience, people that want to start understanding some of this stuff and work their way up and learn more about technology, but don't have a good foundation to start with. So you do several talks on Saturday.
What we try to do is have a little bit of something for everybody. We don't want the DCC to be an exclusive club. We want anybody and everybody who has an interest to be able to come out there. By offering the intro to session, it's a parallel session on Saturday, parallel with the main session. But we'll do things like introduction to APRS, introduction to HF digital modes. This year, Larry Wolfgang, QEEK's editor, did an introduction to surface mount soldering. So really, any topic that is of interest from an introductory point of view for those who are really getting in on the ground floor, we find out what the interest is there, and we find a speaker, and we put that on Saturday.
Now, where does the audience for the DCC come from? The conference itself moves around the country. It's not in the same place more than a couple of years in a row so far.
And true, and it's very interesting that the DCC does move around, and it's kind of in its DNA where we go from place to place to place. We basically move east, mid, west. In fact, we're headed west for 2013, is to be able to offer up these local communities the ability for people to come to the DCC, you know, from and from their local, you know, it's a local drive. It's an easy walk, let's say. Whereas the majority will fly in and stay in the hotel, which, of course, is expensive. You know, an airplane ticket and 3 or 4 nights in the hotel room is certainly has its cost. But we usually have from about 100 to 125 attendees every year. And I would say roughly 60 to 70% of those are people who return, who fly in from to the DCC. And then the balance is basically the local group that comes and sees the DCC for the first time. And I've heard this story many times. It's like, I was at my first DCC when it was in my hometown, and here I am traveling to the DCC year after year. So they got to experience it firsthand and become part of the traveling roadshow.
I was just going to use those words. I've heard you refer to it as the traveling roadshow. So you pick up an audience of people that will then come to it wherever it's being held, flying in, because they have discovered that there's something that is really interesting to them. Mm-hmm. 2012, the one in September was in Atlanta. The year before, it was up in Baltimore. The year before that was in the Seattle area?
It was in the Portland, Oregon area. So it was actually north of Portland in Vancouver, Washington.
And before that, you spent 2 years, I think, in Chicago, which is where I picked up on it.
And you
came to Chicago twice because it was so easy to get in and out of. It was just behind O'Hare Airport. And the guys that put together the facilities did such a great job that you just had to use them at least one more time. Who does the local organizing? How does this thing get put together?
Well, what will happen is when we decide to go east, midwest, we'll ask for volunteers to basically scout in their local area. And we have a way, since we've been doing this year after year, have an introductory letter that the local host can take around to the hotels and basically scout the hotels and get what we would call the conference package from them. And then we kind of get a sense from the local people as to the hotel. Will it handle the DCC? Does it have the amount of room, the space, and that kind of thing? And then we'll pick on one, or I should say we would pick one, and then negotiate a contract with them. And then once we sign the contract, then we announce where the hotel is for that year's DCC.
You got a pretty good contract negotiator because you've been in some big cities where you would expect hotel rates to be much higher than what you guys have ended up with, although being on the weekend, I guess, helps.
I think that does too. We aim for the third week in September. It usually works out, I'm sure. Now, granted, there's some hotels we went to and there were basically what we would call overpriced for what we want to be able to meet in our budget. We do have a budget. We do not make money on the DCC. We run it as a break even. So we have a certain set of criteria in order for us to be able to make that break even. So we do try to strive to get those good room rates and work where we can get good rates with that in the negotiation. And so as a consequence, when you see the announcement, what you haven't seen was all of the negotiations, all of the scouting, and everything that goes behind the scenes before that announcement's made.
How many years have you been running the DCC? Is there an official title, a chairman? How does it, and how long have you been doing it?
Well, personally, I've been doing the DCC now for 12 years. And
basically
kind of have a formula.
Way longer than I thought.
Yeah, and we have a small team that work on that within TAPR. John Koster does a lot of the office work, and of course the whole TAPR board and on officer membership and the local host. So we'll have a good dozen people that work on organizing and running the DCC.
You haven't been able to foist it off on anybody else.
I'm open for business. I mean, anybody who would like to take this on, I'm willing to teach.
I imagine it's a fair amount of work, and you're a very busy person, as we discovered trying to put together this this interview.
Yeah.
So how do you squeeze in the time?
Well, you just kind of make time. It's a good conference. I really enjoy it. I enjoy the fact that so many people get the enjoyment out of that. I'll be truthful in saying that I would be happy to hand it off to somebody else and let them take it on. It is a lot of work. The thing of it is, we've got a really good formula, and really it's going to be teaching that formula. And if you follow the formula, follow the script, you'll be successful.
So next year is scheduled for someplace out west. Do you have a location in mind yet? And it's going to be sometime in September, middle to late September. Do you have a city that you're aiming at this point?
We don't have any particular city at this time. We're just looking out west. So we got a couple of volunteers that are basically scouting around. So as it is right now, I'll certainly take more volunteers to offer up their city. I will give them an idea of what we're looking for, and then they can go out to the hotels and scout around and report back. So basically, first come, first serve. So there's not any particular city that we're driving toward. The more volunteers, the better. It gives us more choice. It gives us more opportunity to be able to find a hotel and get good rates.
Then do you work with a local club to help organize things or promote it? Or if an individual pops up, I guess you work with them. If a club pops up, you work with them.
Correct. And we've done both. We've done individuals, we've done groups of two, and we've done clubs.
All right. So someplace out west, and if anybody out there in the Ham Radio Now audience wants to help out, contact Steve. We'll stick up something that people can see on their screen for finding you.
Right.
So we talked about Friday and Saturday. Something special goes on at the DCC on Sunday. Tell me a little bit about that.
And what Sunday has turned into is what we call the Sunday Seminar, and we'll deep dive a subject for 4 hours, for 8 a.m. till noon. And basically noontime, that's the end of the DCC. So Friday, Saturday are basically the 40 to 45-minute talks, but Sunday we choose a topic, and this is the deep dive. This is the seminar. This is going in and learning something and spending the time to really go over it well. And we've used, as you mentioned, Phil Harmon 1 year did the introduction to software-defined radio. We've had introduction to digital signal processing. Last year, we were fortunate to have Tom Rundow from GNU Radio teach us all about getting started with GNU Radio. And so the Sunday seminar has been really very popular. It's mainly scouting out what that topic is and finding finding a speaker to be able to present that talk. But we always try to find out what's new and upcoming and present it on the Sunday seminar.
Are you beating off people with a stick who want to come make presentations either in the 45-minute talks or the Sunday seminar? Or are there way more people volunteering, or do you have to twist some arms to get them
it amazes me that every year we have a full schedule. So it's, we always seem to have the right size. This year I actually did turn down a couple of talks. We do have quite a few. And I don't want to discourage anybody from saying, oh, he's got enough. Absolutely not. I want to hear from you. I would like to encourage everybody that's interested in coming to the DCC to write it up, submit that paper. That's very important.
It has to
get that in there.
It has to start with a paper being submitted, right? You can't just show up and wing one.
You're going to get first dibs if you have a paper submitted. And then what we'll do is we'll go out and see for the authors if they're going to be in attendance. Not every author that submits a paper is in attendance. And then whatever open slots are available then we do a call for speakers. And then we fill the slots. Yeah, and the intro slots.
You have done a few with a presenter coming in via Skype, which is probably, is Skype being a little bit on the iffy side, probably not what you'd prefer. But if you can get a guy from California and you're doing the show in Baltimore, and that's the only way to get it, something you want, it sounds like you'd do that.
Well, and it was an experiment. We wanted to see if it would work. And actually, we didn't do it this past year in Atlanta, but in Baltimore and in Portland, we were quite successful with it. So we're not predisposed to doing remote presentations. It worked, and we were successful with that. And yeah, we can do that again, though I will limit the number of Skype presentations because the logistics of it is quite difficult.
Yeah, it does take away something from the live presentation. In addition to the fact that the person is not there before and after their talk to meet with people and talk in person, which is the next thing I wanted to discuss. I mean, we are putting at Ham Radio Now, putting the whole DCC, all of the talks online. That doesn't seem to have discouraged people from showing up in person, something we were maybe a little bit worried about initially.
Well, and there has been some worry with that, but I think it's not as founded. I would hope that those who can see it on YouTube, and thank you a million times over, Gary, for placing those up on YouTube for all to see, is that they get a flavor of what the DCC is about. But the talks are what are up on YouTube. What is missing and what can't really be videotaped is what goes on in the hallways, what goes on at lunch, what goes on at the banquet. For example, the interactions, the socializing, the demo room. That's another thing that we forgot to mention about the DCC is we have one of the big conference rooms where we set out tables and we encourage people to bring their projects, set them up for show and tell. Again, you don't have to write a paper to demonstrate. You can bring your projects, set them up, and allow people to see what it is you're doing. In other words, we set up the DCC in such a way that there's multiple ways for people to come and express the things that they're working on. And for these, those in attendance can see many different things. They can listen to the talks. They can talk with people. They can ask questions. They can look at the demos in the demo room. So there's a lot to be had at the DCC, more than just sitting down and listening to the talks.
Yeah. So if you can get a lot out of just watching it online, watching the video, imagine how much more you can get if you're actually there and can talk to the people that were presenting it and listen and ask questions and participate in everything. So,
right.
So the video's good, but live attendance is far, far better.
Right.
You had mentioned a banquet, and there is a speaker at the banquet, which is typically not deeply technical, but it's more technical human interest from what I've observed from the banquets that I've seen so far. And the video of this banquet in 2011 are both on, this one will be online. 2011 was online. So, and that's when you have some spouses and some people that come to the city with their ham and then don't come to the DCC, they go be a tourist, but they show up at the banquet. So there's usually something for them that is not going to overwhelm them with technology.
And we do that quite on purpose, where we look for a guest speaker. And what we try to look for is somebody who can really be inspirational to everybody that's there. The audience and the attendees of the DCC are experimenters. They're the ones who like to really see what's going on in the leading edge of ham radio. And we want to encourage this. This is certainly the community that's very interested in this. So our banquet speaker is somebody to inspire that experimentation, lead them on and give them great ideas. It's also to entertain. We're spending a lot of time listening to technical talks. So when it comes time to do the banquet, let's listen to something a little more lighthearted. Let's listen to something a little more inspirational. So that's purely by design.
And my experience with them is that, I am often in awe of the people that are there and what they're talking about and what they've done, mostly in ham radio, to some extent in their careers, but mostly within our hobby. You get some people that have just done amazing things, and to just have them telling their story, it's like, this should be on worldwide media. Well, wait a minute, it is on worldwide media now. Far more people should be able to hear these stories than are experiencing them now. So that's a big part of why I want to get them online. I appreciate your comments about what I've done, and I am really glad to do it. It's a lot of work, and I will mention at this point very briefly, this little fella back here, that's my mascot. His name is Arvin, Arvin the Piggy Bank. And if people are interested in helping out, it does cost money. It takes a lot of time to produce these things. For me, it is nearly a full-time job, and it needs to become nearly full-time income. So stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, and you can make a contribution. You can also, these days, subscribe to it and make an ongoing contribution every month. And a few people have done that. Surprised me. Somebody suggested I do that, and I found out it wasn't that hard to do. So I set that up. Surprised the heck out of me that several people are actually making routine monthly contributions of $15, $25 or so. That surprised the heck out of me. However, Steve, it bothers me to some extent to be here with my hat in my hand, because so much of what people do in TAPR, the time and energy they invest, is done purely out of the goodness of their hearts, out of their interest in putting something in and giving something back. There is a little bit of commerce that goes on. There is some money exchange because parts have to be bought, things like that. But not, I get the impression not very many people are making much money out of this. They're just doing it because they love it.
And then, and of course, that's the amateur, right? Doing it for the love of it. If it was professional, then we'd be doing it for the monetary reasons on that. I think that's what really makes this community unique and amateur radio as a whole, and there's a lot of extraordinary people, and they're doing some extraordinary things. What we want to do within TAPR and the DCC is basically to showcase all of this, and it's to basically help magnify it. There's, you know, if people are doing extraordinary things, let's shout it to the mountains. Let's help them along. Let's provide them whatever help that they need in order to get that project to blossom. Let's get it out to as many people as possible. Let's provide a technical conference where people can get their ideas published, where they can get up and present it to folks, where it can get video recorded and presented on YouTube. You know, any way we can sit there and get this word out there to more people, that's what we want to do. And you're absolutely right. It's all done for the love and the joy of amateur radio.
Now, I would like to see tens of thousands of people watch the videos. We're not up to that yet. How many people do you want to see attend the conference in person? What kind of a physical participation level can you handle?
Oh, I would love to have 200 or more people there. I could certainly handle that. I can certainly size the conference facilities for 200. The nice thing is, if I could have more people attending, I can bring the conference fees down. But we've had a very consistent, over the past several years, very consistently average of 120 people. So right now, that's what we budget for.
Yeah, I've actually seen in a couple of very limited cases where hams from the local area showed up, and without knowing very much about what they were getting into, they were surprised at how much it cost to get in. They were expecting a Hamfest price. It is more expensive than that.
It is. In fact, I just had the opportunity to attend a microwave update in San Jose, and it costs as much as the DCC. So when it comes to technical conferences, whether it be the DCC microwave update, let's say the Southeast or maybe the EMEs or something like that, anytime you've got a hotel involved, the costs are pretty high. Let's say they're higher than a hamfest. But I think that's kind of the nature of that. And the only way we can really bring those costs down is more people in attendance.
All right. So maybe we can get them for both video and for people showing up in person. You did an introduction at the conference, and I'm going to stick that in here now. I've edited out a lot of the local conference details that wouldn't interest the audience, but there's a few in there so you get an idea of what the weekend is like. So let's take a look at that, and we'll come back for a few closing comments.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And glad to see you all out here today. My name is Steve Bible, N7HPR. I'm the president of TAPR, and we also have a lot of our affiliates here. So I'd like to go through some introductions and lay of the land and a little bit on the schedule here. So let's go ahead and kind of get started. I'd like to introduce the representatives from the ARRL. Is Brennan Price. I'm wondering if Brennan is here. Brennan acts as the ARRL liaison to the Digital Communications Conference. And of course, Brennan is the Chief Technological Officer of the ARRL. So he'll probably be visiting us this weekend. Larry Wolfgang. And Larry, do you want to come up and say a few words?
I would like to welcome everybody here to the 31st Digital Communications Conference, sponsored by ARRL and TAPR. It's great to see so many familiar faces. It's been a few years that I've been attending these now, and start to recognize more and more people every year, I think. So thanks for coming out. Thanks for supporting DCC. And I'll be here all weekend, so if anybody has any questions that I can help you with, or if you want to talk about QEX articles, I'd love to talk to you about writing for QEX, or any other general questions. I also have some sample copies, if any of you are not QEX readers, over in the demo room. There's a few samples, so please help yourself. Thank you.
And thank you, Larry. The director of the Southeast Division is Greg Sarrett. Greg, are you in the audience this morning? Okay. And then we are graced by Gene Clark, W4AYK, Section Manager of Georgia. Gene, would you like to say a few words? Like Larry.
Like Larry. Well, as Section Manager, I want to thank those of you who are not from the section for coming in, and especially thank TAPR for coming to Atlanta, to Georgia, for this meeting. It kind of takes me back to my days of academia in pure science, but I want to say a word for applied science. Remember ARES. I'm very interested in applying all this wonderful technology, and I'm going to sit back and try to be quiet. Maybe I'll be thought of as intelligent that way.
Thank you, Gene. Okay, I'd also like to thank Gary Pierce. I can't thank Gary enough for all of the effort and the work that he's done in videotaping the DCC. Also, his generosity of putting it up online free for use. And now people can go up to YouTube and attend the DCC, so to speak, and see what it's all about. And then, of course, come here, as you all are, here in person, and you'll see that there's much more to the DCC than there is just the talks. You know, there is the demo room, there is the social aspect to it, and the ability here for everybody to network with one another. Please be an advocate for the DCC and telling your friends and your family and you know, maybe even make it a vacation package for your in-laws. And you know, encourage people to come out to the DCC and just tell them about the great time that you had, and then say, hey, you can go up on YouTube and take a look at a few of the talks, and they can get an idea of what the DCC is like. But you are the best advocate because you've been here and you can talk about your personal experiences here. And of course, our job is to make it a very good experience for you. Let's see here. How about a show of hands? The first time, this is your first DCC. Wow, look at that. Well, welcome. I'm glad that you're here. In putting on the DCC, we have a lot of volunteers, and when we move from venue to venue, we have local volunteers, and everybody is out. All right. So we want to thank them for scouting out the hotels in the Atlanta area. Naturally, we selected the Sheraton Gateway here, and working with the hotel has been very, very good. So let us know what you think of the hotel. Let us know what you think of the DCC. All right, so roughly the schedule is we'll have main sessions today and tomorrow. The demonstration room is also Friday and Saturday. Friday night, tonight, is the social. Everybody's invited, okay? So bring your friends. If you've got other ham friends in the local area, call them up, tell them to come on down. We have a cash bar, so basically you pay for the alcohol, but TAPR and ARRL will pay for the sodas. Then we have their introductory talks on Saturday. We have introduction to D-Star, introduction to APRS, and introduction to SMT soldering, or surface mount soldering. And then Saturday night banquet, we're honored to have B-Dale Garby. Truly honored, very honored, extremely honored. Yeah, he's there in the back. So B-Dale's going to talk to us about the sharing, the joy of making. So we're looking forward to this because B-Dale has been very active in his toys, and he's going to tell us about that. Sunday seminar, we're very excited to have Tom Rundell talking about GNU Radio. For those of you who do not know Tom, Tom's pretty much Mr. GNU Radio, so you're going to really learn about it from a person that basically is on the leading edge of GNU Radio. So that pretty much makes up for the schedule. Any questions, anything that I forgot to cover? John?
DVDs.
Okay, the DVDs. Let me go back to the GNU Radio. What we have here is we've created a DVD where if you bring your laptops, you can boot up GNU Radio live on your laptop. But we're printing DVDs. Now, not everybody's laptop may be able to boot from DVD. You may have a CD, or you may need to use a flash drive if you don't have an optical drive. John Ackerman, raise your hand. So if you're one of those people that you think that you might have some trouble booting from a DVD, see John between now and Sunday if you're attending the Sunday seminar. Okay? Does that work, John? Okay. So any other questions?
So that's what it the introduction is like. Is there anything else that we haven't covered that you would like to stick into this video before we do one more thing? Because there was a presentation made for the, let me get this right, the Doug DeMaugh Technical Excellence Award was presented at the DCC, and we'll stick that in here in a moment. But is there anything else about the DCC that you don't think we've covered that you want to add?
Well, I think one thing to bring up about the DCC is a lot, in a similar fashion to Hamvention, that it's been recognized by the manufacturers for announcing radios for the first time. So Kenwood, back in the late 90s, announced the D700 for the very first time, and then the D7 for the very first time. ICOM announced D-Star at the DCC. Gerald Youngblood came and presented even before he created Flex Radio. So there's a lot of movers and shakers there at the DCC. So just to sit there and color what the DCC is and what it can provide for you, there's something for everybody. And I hope that you will come and attend. And please bring a friend.
Well, a lot of people have said that they think ham radio should be more technical. So those of you who are in that camp, put your money and your time and your energy where your proselytizing has been, and show up at the next DCC, which would be next September, someplace way out west. And now let's take a moment to recognize, this will be Larry Wolfgang, WR1B, who's the editor for QEX magazine. And he is making the presentation of the Doug DeMaw W1FB Technical Excellence Award. And then we'll come back and say goodbye.
So we have a special presentation to do today. So I'd like to take this opportunity, and this is the Doug DeMaw W1FB Technical Excellence Award. This award was started, it was established in 1975. It was the ARRL Technical Excellence Award. In 1997, it was changed to, the name was changed to honor the late Doug DeMaw, W1FB, who had been the ARRL headquarters technical editor and was a well-known amateur radio author. I bet many of you here read many of Doug's articles in QST over the years. So as just a quick side note, when I interviewed for a position at ARRL headquarters in 1981, Doug DeMaw and Jerry Hall, K1TD, conducted my interview. And I will say that I was pretty much in awe of both of those fellows, having read antenna books that Jerry had written and having read so much of Doug's material. And it was a little unnerving to think that I was going to be working for these guys. But, you know, as much as I had them way up here on this stand and had so much awe of them, really, you know, they were down-to-earth people, and as I try to be, just an ordinary guy who has a dream job, I would work trying to learn how to be an editor, and I would turn in a manuscript that I had labored over for hours, and then like an hour later, I'd have it back from Doug with blue pencil marks all over it, and then he would sit down with me, and he would go over and explain why he had marked all these changes. And so by doing that over a period of time, I started, I think, to get a little more insight and become a little better editor. And I always appreciated the way that he, you know, sort of took me under his wing and helped me along and helped me to what has turned out to be a long and wonderful career at ARRL headquarters. So It was sad when he retired and moved back home to Michigan, but even sadder when he passed away. So it's really great that we have this way of honoring him with the Technical Excellence Award. It was originally intended only for QST authors, but today we include QEX and really any ARRL publication. And it's an award that's given for someone who did a particularly outstanding job of creating an article showcasing advanced technical topic. And the winners are nominated and votes are cast by the ARRL technical advisors, and then the ARRL board of directors approves the nomination. So I'd like to call Jim Alstrom, N2ADR of Sterling, New Jersey, to come up. Jim was named the recipient of the 2011 Doug DeMaw W1FB Technical Excellence Award. He's recognized for his technical excellence in his research, design, construction, and documentation of a homebrew all-digital HF transceiver. It was published in the January-February 2011 issue of QEX. And the award consists of an engraved 9-inch pewter cup, which I am honored to present to Jim today.
So congratulations to Jim Alstrom, N2ADR. And Jim's article, as Larry said, was in QEX, not in QST, but still some pretty awesome technology that he presented. So thank you for being here with me, Steve. And coming up now over the next several weeks, probably several months, probably wrapping up somewhere around the first of the year, will be the 16 presentations, the 40-minute presentations, and then wrapping up with the three-hour. It sounds like Gilligan a little bit, the three-hour tour.
The Sunday seminar.
Yeah, the Sunday seminar with Tom Rondeau, KB3UKZ, talking about GNU radio.
Right.
In great depth. And that they take me a long time to edit. So they'll be coming out around 1 a week, maybe 2 a week, if I can squeeze them in. And there'll be some other Ham Radio Now programs stuck in between. So it's not going to be all TAPR all the time between now here and the end of the year. But there'll be a lot of TAPR and a lot of DCC right here on Ham Radio Now. So thank you for being with me, Steve. And I will see you next September someplace out west.
Okay, wonderful. And thanks for having me, Gary. And again, thanks a million for putting all the time and effort in editing the DCC talks and placing them up on the web for everybody. And I have to encourage everybody, you know, please put a dollar in Gary's hat. He's put a lot of effort and help there, and let's encourage him to continue on.
I don't think I would miss it from now on. Thank you, Steve. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.